Good afternoon, friends. How many of you use WhatsApp? Yeah, it's very interesting. One of my favorite quotations from Mother Teresa is that she said, family which prays together stays together. And my statement is, family which WhatsApp together stay together. That is really, really true, because I have a large family, extended family, and I hardly have time to spend with them, but I am in touch with all my family members, virtual world, on real-time world. I have some slides, and the two most important slides I haven't added, because if I added those slides, I'll be in trouble. The first slide says, within the next 5 years, smart software will make smarter diagnosis, better diagnosis than doctors. And the second slide says, within the next 10 years, it will become legally mandatory for a doctor to get a second opinion from the software before he starts the treatment. I kept 5 years and 10 years simply because I don't want my professional colleagues to shoot me down. It is going to happen within 5 years. It is a matter of time before doctors will be legally mandated to get a second opinion from the software before starting the treatment. This is the reality. Let's accept it. We have taken several steps in incorporating technology in day-to-day care of the patient. Like, I, as a doctor, I carry 2 mobile phones, 1 phone for my personal use, and the other phone with the larger screen for my patients. And all my visiting cards have the number with the WhatsApp, text messages, but no calls. And I teach them how to send me a voice message, because a lot of my patients are poor. They may have a smartphone, but they are not good in, they can't text their problem. So I tell them that in WhatsApp there is a voice message. I teach them how to do it. And in first few messages, what comes from them is generally a blank message, because they are learning how to do it. But then after some time, they learn. Human beings adapt to the technology very, very fast. You all have been using text. I just want to ask you a question. 1 minute of voice message, if you have to convert it into text, how many minutes it will take you? Yes. 1 minute of voice message. You have conveyed your voice in 1 minute. Instead of voice message, you want to send a text. Guess how many minutes it will take? It will take you anything from 18 minutes to 25 minutes. That is the amount of message you can convey in a voice. Voice is a very powerful tool. Text message doesn't carry the emotion, whereas a voice message conveys the emotion. So going forward, the communication will be voice. Let me come to you with some of the initiative we have taken. We have 50,000 primary health centers in India, and half of them do not have doctors, because young MBBS doctors don't want to work in rural India. And government spends billions of dollars in upgrading and keeping this huge infrastructure called primary health center. But is it really required? What happens in a primary health center? A patient comes, sits in front of a doctor, gets some basic tests done, all the history is taken, examination is done, then prescription is given. All that can be done in a shipping container. We have got 18 such shipping containers in different parts of Rajasthan. we worked with Hewlett Packard to develop software to offer tablet-based healthcare. We have dry chemistry, so about 8 blood tests can be done in the year. So I don't need a lab technician. I don't need a fridge because it's a strip-based test. And we are in the process of now putting digital X-ray machines. And our target is each clinic should get about 50 patients per day. If you don't get 50 patients, you get a truck, put the clinic in the truck and shift it to somewhere else. And all this can be run by any of the trained Ayurvedic doctors with the reasonably good training program. How technology will change. One of the insurance schemes which we conceived, around 12 years ago, we conceived a program called Yashaswini, and our state government launched it. The idea was to have a health insurance with 5 rupees per month. So we convinced 17 lakh farmers to pay 5 rupees per month. Now we have 45 lakh farmers paying 20 rupees per month. And in 10-year period, over 10 lakh farmers had varieties of surgeries in one of the networked hospitals. We have 400 networked hospitals in state. And 1 lakh farmers had a heart operation. Now we are trying to convince our central government that we have 900 million mobile phone subscribers who are spending at least 150 rupees per month just to speak on the mobile phone. If we can collect 20 rupees from each mobile phone subscriber, we can pay for the surgical treatment of 900 million people. This is the power of technology. Poor people in isolation are very weak, but together they are very strong. How do you bring people, poor people together? Use a mobile phone. With one click of a button, you can reach 900 million people. And using technology, we are convinced that India will become the first country in the world to dissociate healthcare from affluence. India will prove to the world that the wealth of the nation has nothing to do with the quality of healthcare its citizens can enjoy. I participate in a lot of debates in England. The NHS is desperately trying to reduce the cost. In US, Obamacare is a big problem for... It's very interesting. You participate in the debates, they all want to reduce the cost of healthcare. But they don't know how much money they spend. Everyone talks about reducing the cost of an operation, but nobody knows how much it costs. So, around 10 years ago, we invested heavily on technology to get the data. We have Oracle ERP on a cloud. We have, with the HR from SAP, it's all on a cloud. We put in our data on the cloud well before rest of the India didn't know what cloud was because we believed in the technology. And in the process, all our 32 hospitals across the country are networked. And we have enough data to produce a profit and loss account on a daily basis. We are in the process of listing our company now. 6 months before, every senior doctor, every administrator was getting an SMS on his mobile phone with the previous day's revenue, previous day's expenses, and the EBITDA margin. If you want to reduce the cost of healthcare, you should know how much it costs. And you should have a dynamic data. For us, looking at the profit and loss account at the end of the month is like reading a postmortem report. Patient is dead, you can't do anything about it. But looking at it on a daily basis is a diagnostic tool, and you can take remedial measures. Today, technology allows you to make it happen. Some of you must be you must be wondering, why should a doctor know what is the profit and loss account of the hospital? Doctors are very, very important people in your effort to reduce the cost and make healthcare efficient. A lot of you are, I'm sure you're associated with the healthcare industry. Can you tell me which is the most expensive medical equipment? Which is the most expensive medical equipment? Can anybody guess?
The PET scan.
Yep. This is the most expensive medical equipment, doctors spend. Because half the things we prescribe, we know it's not going to work. Half the investigations we prescribe, we know it's of no relevance. So unless the doctor becomes part of the healthcare delivery, unless he understands the pain and the suffering patient goes through to raise that 30,000 rupees to take away the pain, you can never reduce the cost. Every hospital thinks that the complaints are a nuisance. Patients complain, the relatives complain, doctors complain. But if you want to go to the next level, you should change your attitude. You call it celebrate complaints. Every complaint is a potential source for you to get better. So we have a simple software tool. Every complaint, we insist it should be in the digital format. Not verbal, no telephone calls. It has to be digitally recorded so that you can evaluate. And then, on an average in every hospital, there can be 50 to 200 complaints. Then you can monitor. Then you can get better. It's very interesting. Some areas you have a constant complaint. Then you know there is a structural problem there and you can address it. I'm just talking about how technology will impact every aspect of healthcare delivery. Around 7 years ago, we wanted to get into liver transplants on babies. But we didn't have anesthetists in Bangalore who were familiar with the liver transplants on children. They were all cardiac anesthetists. So we linked our operation theater to operation theater in Children's Hospital of Philadelphia in U.S. because they have a very good team of cardiac anesthetists. And because it is a night over there when it is day here, they could use their OT facility, and they guided the entire team for doing the pediatric liver transplant during the first 5 liver transplants. And by that time, our anesthetists learned how to do it. Now they are doing liver transplant with great outcome. And this we instituted around 7-8 years ago. Can anybody guess what these 3 men are carrying on their shoulder, the blue bag? Can anybody guess what's inside the blue bag? The blue bag contains their artificial heart. These 3 men were admitted to our hospital 7 years ago for a heart transplant. And we couldn't get the donor heart, so we implanted an artificial heart. See, you'll be surprised, can heart be replaced? These 3 men have been, the heart is the easiest organ to duplicate and substitute. Because heart has no intelligent function. It is a dumb pump. You put in 5 liters, it will put out 5 liters. Every other organ in the human body is intelligent. Brain does a lot of intelligent cellular work. Liver does a lot of intelligent cellular work. Every organ does intelligent cellular work, but heart only works like a pump. Any pump can replace it. So we started investing on these artificial hearts for a long time because our prediction is that within the next 20 years, artificial heart will become the commonest implant inside the human body. And within 20 years, when people die, so-called died, before you bury or burn them, you have to switch off the artificial heart because their heart will be still working. This is the reality. Because if the heart works, a lot of the other organs, if it works or not, it doesn't matter. If your brain works, I hope everybody's brain is working, but even if it doesn't work fully, it's okay. But if the heart doesn't work, everything comes to a standstill. So, with the new technology advances in healthcare, people are going to celebrate 100th birthday. And when that happens, one organ which can give you trouble is the heart. Because if people live long enough, most patients who had a bypass or a valve or any operation will eventually land in heart failure. And they can be very well supported with the artificial heart. Now, how expensive it is to change things in healthcare. All we have to do is to look differently towards every problem. I'll just give you some of the examples what we have done. When a patient gets admitted for a bypass grafting in India or in US or in Europe, generally the spouse stays with the patient. And the spouse is not allowed to touch the patient in the hospital. They can't give medicines, they can't touch the patient. But exactly 4 days after the heart operation, we call the wife and give her one plastic bag with all the medicines, and we tell her that, look, your husband is okay now, you take care of him. And she's lost because there's one big scar here, one big scar in the leg. She doesn't know what to do with him. So we launched a program called Care Companion Program. We often get the graduate students from Stanford Business School. My son was a student of Stanford Business School. So they keep coming for new projects. So one of the batches, we gave them a concept of Care Companion. The idea is to produce 12 videos of 1 minute each, which will demonstrate specific task to train the spouse to take care of the patient after a heart operation. Simple thing like wound dressing, giving the medicines on time, physiotherapy. These are the simple tasks: maintaining input-output chart, checking the blood pressure, checking the pulse rate. These are simple tasks. So they made documentaries of films for 1 minute, which can be downloaded into the, most patients do have smartphones. You download into their phone and you can ask them to see it few times, then you can teach them. With the digital BP operators, anybody can be taught how to check the blood pressure. For 2,000 rupees, you can get a digital BP operators. So when we started, it's very interesting. We started in a place called Mysore, then we started in Bangalore. We call the nurses, senior nurse would call, say, 30 relatives. The spouse will stay in one room, and they teach them how to check the blood pressure. Then teach them how to check the pulse rate. How do you teach people to check the pulse rate? You ask them to put their finger on the radial artery. Then you teach them. Then after 5 minutes, the nurse would ask, what is your pulse rate? What is your pulse rate? And then you get answer, 70, 80, 60, various. Then all of a sudden, one person said 32. And everyone laughed at him, thinking that this guy didn't know how to check the pulse rate. His pulse rate was really 32, and next day he had a pacemaker. So you can actually train people to do those things with very little effort. And interestingly, eight months ago, British Parliamentary Commission chose Care Companion Program as the best empowerment tool of 2014. So, all I am saying, you see, how much it costed us? It costed us nothing. The message I am trying to convey is that whenever you have any project to undertake, first thing you should tell yourself that I have no money, but I want to do it. If you say I have $100 million in the bank, let me do this, believe me, you will squander the $100 million, you get nothing in return. Because in my experience, when you have money in the bank, your brain stops working. talking about another important program we launched. This is a bed sore following heart operation. The incidence of bed sore following heart operation across the world is 7% to 40%. It's okay for an American hospital which does 50 or 70 heart operations in a month to have 7% to 40% of bed sore. We do close to 700 heart surgeries a month. If 10% or 40% patients develop bed sore, you need another hospital to take care of these patients. So 4 years ago, our nurses decided that we should eliminate bed sore. And they developed a protocol. Again, the protocol is based on technology. It's very simple technology, no sophisticated software. When a patient gets admitted to the hospital, they realize which are the areas which is prone for bed sore. They inspect the site. If it is suspicious, they take care of that before the heart surgery is done. Then from the ward, patient goes to the operation theater. The theater nurses again inspect the site, and if there is a suspicious area, they take a picture on their from their camera phone to record that the patient came to the operation theater with a red area to protect themselves, saying that ward nurses gave, we didn't give, because she has evidence in her phone. Then from the operation theater, when the patient went to the ICU, ICU nurses again looked at those spots to find out whether the patient came to the ICU with a bed sore. Essentially, what they are trying to do is passing the blame to somebody else, but the phone camera photos are the evidence to protect themselves. In the process, what has happened in the last 3 years, they eliminated the bed sore. We hardly had a bed sore in our hospital. This is nothing but a strategy to take care of a particular problem. And interestingly, this article of our nurses, How to Prevent Bed Sore, was published in American Nursing Journal, which is one of the most prestigious journals in U.S., as the protocol to prevent bed sore after heart operation. So this has become a standard nursing protocol now in most hospitals. Just want to show you that how computers are intelligent. This is in 1997, when the technology was still not up to the level. Gary Kasparov, the ruling chess champion, was beaten by Deep Blue. You look at the frustration of Gary Kasparov. That is the kind of intelligence computers had in 97. And now you can imagine where they have progressed. One of the biggest problems in healthcare today is the complications developing in the hospital. Hospitals are not very safe for the patients. You can see two photos. The first photo is the smiling face of Jacqueline Kennedy, and the lead article is about our hospitals are killing us. This article appeared in US 50 years ago. How unsafe hospitals are. 50 years ago, that was a challenge. 50 years later, Forbes magazine covered another article about how unsafe American hospitals are. And American hospitals are some of the safest hospitals on the planet. And they, American hospitals itself, are not very safe for the patient. If 200 patients get admitted to an American hospital and spend one night, one of them die due to medical error. It's not medical negligence, it's a medical error. Getting admitted to an American hospital is 10 times riskier than skydiving. Why? It's simply because doctors and the hospitals do not follow the protocol. Why they don't follow the protocol? Because protocols are written down in a nice booklet and it is inside the cupboard. Now, how do you bring protocol and the process on the mainstream of delivering healthcare? So, 3 years ago, we started investing on using iPad as a tool because iPad is mobile. So, we started using iPad to put the patient data, and you can build a lot of intelligence to it. So, today, our ICUs do not have the paper, they have iPads. In day-to-day healthcare, how does the technology help? I'll give an example. We have a young diabetologist. She gave me these pictures recently. Her name is Poonam. She runs a diabetic clinic online using WhatsApp. This is a typical patient. The patient's son called her from Maharashtra about his mother. So she took the history, like every doctor does, on a piece of paper. After the history is over, using the WhatsApp camera, she took a picture. Now, Poonam has the patient's history, so next time when the patient calls, he doesn't have to ask the same questions. And patient also has a copy. Then Poonam wanted to know how big the lady was. And the son took a picture of the mother. And now she has an idea about how big the lady is. Then Poonam wanted to know what medicines patient is taking. Lay people can't read the medicines. You know, it's very difficult to pronounce. So the son put all the tablets on the table and took a picture. So they could read. The doctor Poonam could decipher all this. But the beauty is not this. The beauty is Poonam is sitting at home, taking care of her child, and treating patients in different parts of the world, sitting at home. This is going to be the game changer. Because if Poonam has to work in the hospital, she has to come to the hospital at 9 o'clock. That means she has to leave the house at 7 o'clock. And the preparation and everything. Again, the same cycle repeats at 5 o'clock. And half the time, she is worried about a little child. Now, shifting the care from the clinic to the patient's house online will dramatically change everything what we do. Today we may use WhatsApp, tomorrow we'll have our own apps, which is secure, which is controlled by us, with all the securities. So this will dramatically change the doctor's practice. They may get paid less for every consultation, but they will see 10 times more patients. In the end, patient is happy, and the doctor is happy because doctor can go on holiday and take a short break and see his patient wherever he is. These are the tools we are developing for communication. Just one of our cardiac surgical resident developed an app for surgery training, the surgical trainees. Every surgical trainee needs to have a logbook. He looked at the best logbooks in the world. He wasn't happy. And in 6 weeks, he developed this app called Surgeon's Logbook. And then he decided to put it on the Play Store. So the Android, the Play Store. And in 3 months, 12,000 surgeons across the world downloaded it and they're using it. This is the power of how the software programmers in this country can come up with breakthrough products with remarkable ease. This is another app we are developing for having patients' medical information in the phone. Now, all this transformation can only happen in India. We always think that these things can happen in US because they have the resources, they have all the required infrastructure. This transformation can never happen in US or any of the developed world. The reason is the data security. Data privacy. In United States, if a software engineer loses the patient data from his laptop, approximately the minimum settlement fees will come to about $10 to $12 million. So no hospital will ever give you the patient data for you to develop these tools. In US, unfortunately, patient data is more sacred than the patient's life. But we are still privileged in this country. We don't have those draconian laws, and we have brilliant software engineers who can create amazing things. Like, I'll just give you a glimpse of American healthcare, why I am so bullish that all this transformation can happen only in India. Vijay is a friend of mine. He's an intensivist in Kaiser Permanente Hospital in the U.S. He has to deal, look at the number of tools he has to deal with. There is one computer which is on a desktop. Then he has a landline. Then he has a mobile phone. Then he has a slightly bigger phone. Then he carries a pager. 60% of the American hospitals still doctors carry pagers. In India, you want to see a pager, you have to go to a museum. And because they don't have a mobile platform, they put a computer desktop on a table with wheels, and they call it as computer on wheels, cow. As if they have made a big advancement. Why do you need a cow and the calf? All you need is a mobile platform. But they can't develop these at the pace in which we can develop. A typical surgeon has to run with 7 different gadgets when all those things can be put inside one mobile phone, and we can do everything much more efficiently. And that transformation, I believe, will only happen in India. I just want to give you a glimpse of, my time is over. We built a hospital in Cayman Island, which is very close to Florida. It's about less than an hour from Florida. And when a patient is in the ICU following a heart operation in Cayman Hospital, when the nurses and the doctors are sleepy, the patients are monitored from Bangalore. When it is 12 o'clock at night in Cayman Island, it is 11 o'clock in the afternoon. Our nurses were bright and active. They can monitor the patient like on a real-time basis. This is the advantage we have in India. When it is night in those countries, when people are sleepy, our doctors and nurses are awake, and we will be able to monitor all their patients in critical care unit. And this is the beauty of what technology can do. And my last slide for you is why medical community is so reluctant to adopt technology. This is the inherent problem of all the doctors in our country, in this world. Doctors do not want to change. We always feel that tomorrow is an extension of today, without realizing that tomorrow is different. This is in 1854 sometime, a person called Lennox invented the stethoscope. And today you can't imagine a doctor without a stethoscope. For 20 years, no doctor wanted to use the stethoscope. This is the Times of London speaking on the stethoscope, which happened at that time. They are talking about stethoscope, that it will ever come into general use, notwithstanding its value. It's extremely doubtful because its beneficial application requires much time and gives a good bit of trouble both to the patient and the practitioner, because its hue and character are foreign and opposed to all our habits and association. This is the doctors talking about stethoscope. Then you can imagine what doctors will talk about healthcare. But we have no choice. We are in a dynamic world where every year 56,000 young doctors graduate who were very, very familiar with the technology, and they will change the world. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Sorry? Sure.
Thank you so much, sir. That was such an interesting presentation. We just loved that you were here with us in our midst. May I now request Mr. Didi Pulkasta, Managing Director and CEO, ABP Private Limited, and Chairman of Infocom, to kindly come forward and present a memento to Dr. Devi Prasad Shetty. Thank you so much for being here with us today. We are truly privileged
Thank you very much.
I would also now like to invite Dr. Moshumi Ghosh, Founder, Trustee and Director. So we request you to kindly remain on stage. I'd like to request Dr. Moshumi Ghosh, Founder, Trustee and Director of Team Future, to kindly come and present a memento to Dr. Shetty. It is a coffee table book by Raghu Rai on Kolkata, okay, in yes, color by Team Future Impression, a group organization of Team Future.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Doctor.